anything for Linda.
Yeah.
And thanks, why not?
Everybody. She is fantastic.
You know what, she is. You're funny as hell, I'll tell you what. When that sound was going off for your girl.
I saw you over there going, doing this
turn. You're guiding her, like, do something.
That was funny. That was funny. Yeah, that's what we saw.
I said, Linda's telling her what to do now.
That was funny.
Hello? Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to
Coffee with Linda.
So when I introduce guests, Cricket, are you paying attention? This is we're rehearsing. Okay. I'm gonna pretend. Tell me your name again.
Linda.
Linda, right? Linda, you're gonna pretend to be a guest, and we're gonna test you. Okay. Now we're gonna bring my good friend Linda. Linda. That's it. Thank you, Linda. Oh my God, this is so exciting. Hi, everybody.
Hi.
Oh, wow, I'm having this amazing dream that we're doing this funny talk show every day. Oh my God, and I want to thank all of you. I'm going to probably tear up here, but it's been really amazing. Everyone, the kindness that's been going on this cruise, and everyone connecting with each other, and then who was at the show last night? The acoustic. Okay, how great was that? Anita. Okay, feeling.
Overwhelmed.
Because what happened last night?
He sang a song that I've been requesting for
11 million years.
Yes, and I think last night I felt more of the passion she feels about hating singing that song. it really is a hard song to sing because of the meaning behind it, and I was overwhelmed that she did it, and even though she felt that way, but gosh,
it's awesome, isn't it?
Yeah.
Right? And I got to have a really unique experience. Usually I'm back at the monitor with Ozzy, you know? And I thought, you know, hey, if ever I was going to jump in the pond, let's do it. And so I jumped in. I was in the third row with you guys. And it was, because I never get to see her face. When she's singing, I have 10,000 pictures
the side of her head.
Right. So to be able to be in there with you guys, that was really,
feel it.
Yeah, and I told Melissa afterwards, this is so overwhelming because what I'm hearing, to be there and all of you guys there and saying things like, oh my God, she's singing it, no way! Does Anita know? Tell her! And then Tracy and Chris here. You guys here? Where are you? Oh my God, you guys, my back door. When you,
I oh couldn't. Oh my God!
All right, Tracy, let's talk about this. Why do you love? Oh, okay, yes, that's much better because I'm. There we go. Okay, Tracy, yes. Your favorite song, right?
Yeah.
And how long have you been asking for her to do it?
11 million years.
Yeah. It was so sweet because then you guys started singing it to each other.
Yeah.
And then everyone around you started taking pictures of you guys loving the song.
It was really, really amazing. Like that's one of the first songs I learned to play of hers on the guitar.
Aww.
So that's one of the reasons it's really special to me. And the other reasons are really kind of corny, but
We like corny.
I'm a big dreamer, and to be that person who's with your back in the grass and your eyes to the sky, you know, it's got that whole feeling to it. It just means the world to me. So that was a moment. Definitely.
And as a newlywed, I'm sure that it had more. You know, Tracy and Chris just got married. So. Yay! Well, no, it was June.
July.
Okay. And I just want to know. I want you guys to know. We just love you guys so much, and that meant the world watching you respond.
We love you
to
too.
Thanks. And what's great today is we're not going to rush as much, okay? Because we have a little extra time, because I know a lot of you guys are going to your picture taking with us, and I thought, well, we'll be like, you know, the fun family room where people can hang for a little while before. So we might go a little over 10, so who knows, okay? And to keep our tradition going, if you have any other questions that you have about Melissa that if I can, I will answer,
if you're
behaved. Does she ever sleep? Yes.
She goes all the time.
That's why, big reason we're doing
she
this.
She never stops.
Well, because she gets her sleep.
There it is.
Yeah. Feel free to do a put on phone. Thank you.
It just seems like she's going like ever running by.
No, you know what? And this is something she wants everyone to know is since the cancer,
yeah,
she changed her whole life, including, and she helped save my life. And a big part of that is sleep. Okay, as women, we don't get enough sleep, mm-hmm. right?
I agree.
True story.
Yeah, okay, and so here's the key. She does not eat after 6 o'clock, usually, which kills me because I'm always starving after a show because I've been watching her show. I don't know what she's been doing, but I'm exhausted after watching. So, me and the band are like, and she's like, no, she will not eat. That helps her sleep better.
Well, there you go.
We protect her sleep so mm-hmm. much, and I appreciate all of you understanding mm-hmm. that. And to take that in, that means a lot to us because that is the core. That and drink it. I know I keep saying it, water, water, water. Mm-hmm. Just drink as much water as you can. Exactly.
Cheers.
And yes, she does get enough sleep. So, hello, we're all listening a little bit, right?
No. No, both not
moved. It's like you worry about her, you know, and want her to fall out.
Exactly, yeah. So, and you saw her last night. She's just badass, right?
She's out of control.
I happen to think the greatest American guitar player right now is a middle-aged woman. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Very much.
Absolutely.
Good story.
But really, I really want you guys to know. It's so profound. This is our third cruise, and the feeling on the boat that everybody. Last night, sitting with you guys in the audience, I realized, oh man, you guys have been a community now for almost 30 years. Mm-hmm. And let's all really, really take care of each other, you know, including when we leave the boat, because what little things, wisdom we can pass on. I did TV for many years, 30 years in television in Hollywood, which was my dream, but there was like, I got there, I was like, Hollywood's great, everyone likes each other. Oh wow, people are cranky and weird. And so, but they're not. People, I think, sometimes we have to give them grace who don't know how to be more positive in situations. That's what we all have as fans of this music and this feeling of, hey, we can leave the boat and take this with us. You know, that's what my wife is really good at telling the world, so.
Is she gonna do another cruise?
Oh God, we're doing another cruise. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely. You have a question? Or are you just waiting?
No, I love you.
I love you too.
And I love Nurse Jackie.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Woo.
I just wondering, you talk about Nurse Jackie and you have the crazy fucked up nurse in your life. How did you come up with Nurse Jackie?
Oh, that's a great question. Okay, how did Nurse Jackie happen? That's a show I did for Showtime. Thank you. You know, it was a beautiful timing that happened with that because my own experience with sobriety and addiction, it was so great meeting Edie and then going, okay, if I need to do a story about a lot of times when you create a show, you can put your own stuff in it, right? And so I thought, God, if I had Edie Falco, this is wish fulfillment. All the things I ever wanted to do, I'll just do it through her, you know? And the thought of a character who could heal others but not heal herself, yeah, that was the journey I wanted to take. So, yeah, but thank you. That's
a lot of us healthcare professionals.
Oh man, and nurses are my absolute favorite. I think that the nurses are unsung heroes.
You're better than the doctor.
What's that?
I think they're better than the doctor.
I'm saying that. Right, and nurses heal, and doctors tend to just, well, no, doctors are great too. I'm just happy that the show touched some people.
But some
so.
Are busier.
Yeah.
And
that's. And what's great about nurses, I mean, we did one episode where, and this was for Melissa's experience, because I'd watched her through cancer not be given any alternatives for her pain. And so we somehow back then got her, anyway, Nurse Jackie at one point, she has to take her patient out of the, and makes him an apple bomb and gives him the pot.
Yeah.
And
nice!
Him. Yeah, because so many of my nurses said, we don't want to be able to do this, so... yeah, support your nurses. Yeah. anyone else got a question or something they want to share from the other
line?
Oh, wait, where?
Left.
My left or your left? Hi.
I actually have a question for you, Linda, given that you were in acting and it did it well. I was wondering, can you tell me about your impression of the YouTube movement and what it's really like? Because all I ever get, of course, are media reports, which don't also
She's talking about the Me Too movement, which we're actually going to talk about a little bit today. It's interesting, and how, yeah, I was usually the only, am I doing something weird by standing here? There, that's better. I was usually the only woman in the writer's room, you know, it was me and 20 guys, and when I got to Hollywood in the early 90s. But what helped me was, I have an amazing father, who, Paul Wallem, who later we'll do a video for them because I send them little videos. They're 85, my parents. They've been together since they were 14. They're just, Yeah, and my dad taught me, and he sold farm equipment my whole life, and I worked at the store, and I saw him be really lovely with people. So when I got to Hollywood and saw men weren't being that, I was like, huh, what's with you? You're weird. So I would say that out loud. And then go, wow, you must have a lot of pain. Let's talk. And they would go, So I learned early, you just, and I had to do a dance with a certain network president who recently got fired. I'll tell this quick story. I won't say his name, but he ran a network that rhymes with
PBS.
And I was doing Sybil. I don't know if you know that sitcom Sybil. That was one of my best jobs. And Sybil's great. And we was the first day this guy was coming to be the president of our network, and we were already a big hit. And he's about this tall. And he wanted alone time with my star. So why do you need alone time with him? And then I find out, I know when they want to do that. And I said, not going to happen. And he looked up at me and said, who are you? I said, I'm your executive producer and your worst nightmare. He thought I was being funny.
Good for you.
And then got canceled. But no, anyway. No, I don't mean to make light, but you know what? It really was an issue. And what's amazing now, doesn't matter what happened before, it's a new day. It's a new day. My daughter is 22, and I know she's not going to ever let anyone feel her, make her feel less than when she's at work. I do believe after all these years, and we have some friends that are going to talk today, in any situation, you don't have, it's for women especially, don't get underneath it. You got to just stay. It can happen walking down, it can happen at the grocery store. I play a game sometimes, nothing against our straight white men, I love you guys, but there's a game I play sometimes. I'll walk down the street and go, well, this guy, I'm not going to yield to him. I'm just going to walk and see what happens. And finally, they wake up and go, and they walk. And I go, you know. And I taught Bailey that. I said, Bailey, don't ever, because as women, we're always bumping into furniture going, oh, I'm sorry. Stop saying I'm sorry.
Yeah.
But it's a great question. We're going to talk some more about that today. Okay?
One more question. Hi, Linda.
Hi.
I'm just curious, what was the title of the song, the first song you were talking about that's hard for Melissa to perform?
Stay.
Stay. Stay, right? Wasn't, yeah. And what, is that what she said last night? She said, and God, forgive me, which album is that from? It was a cover. Oh, the one, oh yeah. No, she says it's really hard. This is sweet. It's hard because, you know, rumor has it she had some painful relationships in the past.
Good answer, amen.
Do you guys know how grateful I am? These are our, not only our dearest friends, these are our partners. This is, do you guys met Josie and Cricket yet, right over here? Oh my God, wait, these are our partners with Etheridge Farms. These are our, we are going to talk, any questions you have about CBD, right here, okay? And that's one of their, one's of seven children. Thank you. That's Zane right there. Oh, where's Jai? Is he sleeping? All right, everyone come with me. We're going to go wake up Jai. He would freak out. He would freak out. That would be amazing. We have so many wonderful people today. So we're going to hop in with our first guest. Oh, we love this woman so much, and if you haven't seen her yet, I'm serious. We go way back with the lovely, beautiful Serena Ryder.
Yeah.
We're good.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thanks for getting up early.
Oh, yeah. I'm always up early. Oh, is your thing not up?
Never. I don't have my glasses on, so.
And the show came to a screeching halt.
Check. There we go.
Okay.
Hi, Serena.
Hey, Linda.
Oh, my God. We love you so much.
Don't we love Linda so much?
I love you.
We met Serena, 8 years ago?
That's right.
Does anyone know what, when Serena first played with Melissa, she was opening for her, which, was that the Fearless Love Tour?
Yes.
Thank you, Paul. And I remember the moment we met you, it was outside the hotel.
Yes, in Edmonton.
In front of the bus.
Freezing.
It was freezing.
It was minus 24 degrees Celsius, yeah.
And what was your first impression of all of us? Because you had to get on a circus bus with us.
I was so overwhelmed with gigantic love. I felt my heart was exploding when I first saw. Like, you're going on tour with Melissa Etheridge and her amazing, beautiful girlfriend at the time.
We were just
girlfriends. But I was instantly in love. I felt like I'd come home, honestly.
We felt like we knew you too. And this one, I gotta tell you, I know it's early, but I'm gonna make you do a little bit of it.
Oh, okay.
No one imitates Melissa better than this one. She's talking about when you've had a little too much to drink.
Right. So when I used to drink, I used to sing one of Melissa's songs the next morning, and I would sing it like this. I'm really hungover. Sing it, but now I'm like, I'm really sober.
When was the first time you heard Melissa? Because I know she was big.
Oh my gosh,
you know, you're from Canada.
I'm from Canada, and Melissa used to be everywhere, right? She was everywhere. Her music is still everywhere. It's something that I grew up listening to, it's something that was always around all of the time. When I was young, I remember I played my first show when I was 8 years old at a Legion downtown in this place called Millbrook, Ontario. So I grew up in a village that was just under 1,000 people. And it was a village in a valley, and there were no buses, no trains. There was one taxi cab driver named Ernie Doig who ended up being my manager.
Whoa!
Yeah, and he booked me my first show at the Legion. Downtown Millbrook, so it was all these older vets. There was probably about 12 people, my mom and dad and sister included. And I had several people come up to me constantly and be like, you sound like Melissa Etheridge. I loved that. That was the coolest thing ever.
So what was your first, did you ever sing her songs? Would you sing her songs?
Come to My Window was a real good karaoke for me.
You want to do a little? Just how you do it.
Okay. Come to my
Okay.
I'm just getting dizzy even just like moving on the chair.
Here's my other favorite thing about you, Serena. In the back of the bus, when we were traveling, it was so cold, and you sit in the back of the bus. It was my favorite after a show.
That was my favorite time, too.
My wife finishes the show.
With Sandy, too.
Sandy.
My woman manager is over there, Sandy.
He loves Sandy.
Yeah.
After a show, it's so boring, but you know, Melissa takes off her makeup, we get her in the shower, we put her in her PJs, and then we get her in the bus, right?
After the bus.
And usually it takes a little while to, you know, so we might have a little relaxation And in the back, we'd be in the back, and all of a sudden, you would start just singing something, and I would think, what's going to happen? And then you guys would start, all of a sudden, you guys are singing some Linda Ronstadt, or you're singing, everything. It was
so
just...
We would write songs.
And write songs?
I think my phone is my iPad,
and my iPad is my phone. Right here.
We're getting confused. Which one was the iPad and which one was the phone? Because phones are so fucking huge now. It's like, that's not my phone. That's not my phone.
The other thing that I loved was that you, one of my very first jobs in Hollywood, I was in 91, I worked for Carol Burnett, my hero, her return. And it was her return to
variety, and so I loved Carol. I mean, it was my dream come true to work for her, and when we talked to Carol, you were the first person I've ever met who can actually imitate Carol singing. Nobody does.
Give it to us.
Can you do a little
bit? Okay, sure. Well, it's from Annie, because I was obsessed with her as Miss Hannigan.
Okay.
Little girls, everything around them is so little. Every woman with feelings. I like a man to nibble on my ear.
To sing together.
That would be amazing.
That would be good.
Now, Serena, you still have two more performances, or how?
Yeah, I'm performing today on the pool deck at 2:15.
2:15, do not miss that.
And then
you've
got 80s night.
An 80s night.
Oh my gosh. And songwriter circle.
Yeah. Oh, what happens that?
The songwriter circle is another layer.
You please go see Serena, please. Yes. And I hope you can do a little song. You're gonna hang with us.
I'm gonna hang, yeah.
And but would you like to do a little song for us? Be my ethnic man. We all remember. Oh God,
ethnic woman.
Ethnic woman.
Be your ethnic woman.
So okay, we're gonna get you. I'll cover while you.
Okay, cool.
You go up there.
Okay.
No, we bring you down.
I'm gonna come down here because you can't see. Okay.
Oh, so, yeah. So
I'll
good
stay
for
here.
You. Good. Filled.
This is the music for the.
Yeah, that's nice. This is set up music.
Can I have the red electric guitar, please?
Yes. Yes. That what? What was that,
or maybe is it just acoustic? Whatever makes sense.
We're going to keep the drumming going.
It's Jesse.
Oh, Jesse's probably sleeping. Is
it your assistant?
Cool.
These guys have been amazing. Guys, happy anniversary, by the way. Today is your anniversary, right? Oh, I meant for her to say it to you on stage last night, but she got some of it out. But happy anniversary. How are we doing? Are we filling? Okay, good. I'll shut up now.
I guess I'll start off with a song that Melissa got up and sang with me the other night.
Yeah, really, really I love this song. This one of my favorite songs.
And Melissa actually got up and sang it with me at the Troubadour a few years ago, and I was so stoked.
Which is an amazing video. You want to check it out.
Yeah, there's one online, which is really cool. So this is a song about my first time kind of going away from the little village in Millbrook. I was 11 years old, and it was I went to the nearest city with my two best friends to visit them. The city was like 75,000 people, so it was gigantic to me. I grew up in a town of under 1,000 people. And I was so excited because it was the Peterborough exhibition. And I got lost. I got lost when I was 11 years old and thousands of people. And there's like, you know when you go to the fair or the exhibition and there's music pumping and there's like carnies everywhere and I'm stoked. Are you supposed to sing carnies alone?
Yeah, I
love carnies. Yeah. But I got lost and I thought it was the end of the world. And I wanted to write a song about the power of music and how it can change any situation. And I got lost as an adult as well. I really, really suffered from really severe depression for a while. It was right before I met you guys, actually, and Melissa and Linda really helped me out with music and love to kind of get out of it. But back to when I was 11, I was completely lost, never thought I would find my way back, and my favorite song came on, and I forgot that I was lost.
Aww.
I completely forgot that I was lost, and I just started walking around and dancing and singing to my favorite song, which was, and if you want to buy me flowers, just go ahead. Which is a fucking awesome song, right? Okay. So anyways. I wrote a song about those two situations and the power of music to bring you back from anything. It's called Merry Go Round.
Have you ever found
down. Have you ever looked up? Laughed at the big blue sky? Have you ever wondered? Have you ever wondered? Another amazing thing about being married to Melissa is, again, all the amazing people I get to meet. And we got to meet our next guest. Gosh, Heather, when was it? How long ago was it? It was during the...
10 years ago.
When Melissa was doing some campaigning, and she was asked to call the superdelegate. During the whole democratic process, and a certain delegate called her, and most people call and go, oh my God, I'm a big fan. This woman called and said, okay, tell me exactly what your thoughts are and why you need my vote. And Melissa was like, oh God. And it started the most amazing conversation with one of the smartest, most beautiful women I know. I just want you guys all put your hands together for Heather Mizeur.
This one.
Hi, yes.
This is wild because they were all at our wedding, so this is like, wow, it's such an amazing flashback. Hi, Heather.
Hi.
Uh oh, you on?
Let's see. Do you want to try this one?
Here,
try. Check mic. Here,
check mic. Hold on. It's going to come. Yay. Okay.
Hi. Hi. Hello, everyone.
Hello.
I don't even know where to start with you. How do we start about this? What and how Melissa basically took you by the ankles and threw you into a spiritual journey?
Oh my goodness. Yeah. Well, as you mentioned, our journey started as a political one. I was a superdelegate. I was a Democrat National Committee member, also a legislator from Maryland. And when Barack and Hillary were, you know, going toe-to-toe in that 2008 election cycle, everyone thought it was going to come down to who got what superdelegates lined up. And I was getting calls from everybody, from Hillary and Chelsea and Bill to Barack.
The Pope.
And that would have been, no. And at that time, that Pope I wouldn't have been interested in talking to. But I'm getting these calls, but I'm in the middle of my legislative session. And to me, my job number one at the time was how I was performing and the laws I was trying to pass in the Maryland General Assembly. And we were working on marriage equality and all these other important initiatives in Maryland, which we did pass before. I have to give a shout out there to my gorgeous wife, Deborah Mizeur, as well, because she was involved in that every step of the way. So I was ignoring all these calls from everyone, and they would just go to my voicemail. I literally turned my phone off because I didn't want to be taking this barrage of calls. And then I get one from Melissa Etheridge. And I turned to Deborah and I said, that might be one I return. And as Linda always was fond of saying, well, Melissa is on the lesbian dollar bill. she is our queen. And but I did wait until my legislative session was over. So I did return Melissa's call when I didn't return anyone else's call, but it was like a couple of months later. And we have this amazing connection where it wasn't about, oh my God, I'm such a fan. It was about politics and democracy. And we both realized that we were these nerdy kids that carried around pocket constitutions when we were kids. Because we loved the experiment of democracy in this country and what it could be. Because it's all about us.
Yeah.
And how we're connected to each other and how we can have a government of, by, and for the people if we're engaged in it and we make sure that our voices are heard. And so, as you can imagine, over this last decade, our politics have been through quite a journey, right?
Why? What's going on?
And in the midst of all of this, we started blending conversations about our political with the spiritual, because really we shouldn't be divorcing those two things. We are all of these things. Our who we are spiritually impacts how we show up in the world politically in our civic engagement. And I grew up, speaking of the Pope, I was a Catholic girl that never left the church because I believed in change within an institution and that you can stay and show a different way. And along the way, started gathering other traditions. I'm also a Buddhist woman, and I'm also someone who practices deep Native American spiritual teachings. But through this journey, Melissa started talking to me more and more about sort of consciousness raising elements. And in the beginning, she would talk to me about some things where I would be like, okay, that's a bit crazy. And I would turn and I would think to myself, I'd have this little conversation over here, they'd be like, she's a rock star, it's okay. You know, it doesn't make sense.
I remember some of those conversations because your eyes would be like, honey, go, it's okay, you just give her time, it'll make sense. Yeah, go on.
I credit Melissa with breaking me out of my left brain, linear, logical, everything's black and white kind of view of things, and really expanding out into a bigger, broader picture and vision of what all is. And so while I was in politics, I was incorporating all of this into how I showed up in the world. And when I ran for governor of Maryland, the hard part about being a pioneer and being ahead of the time is that I'm always about 4 years ahead of where people are ready to be. So in 2014, I was running on a platform that only Bernie Sanders could dream of a couple years later. And we were talking about legalizing marijuana and using the revenue for universal pre-K to eliminate the disparity in education.
Right.
And we were talking about giving middle class tax cuts paid for by bringing the millionaires tax back. And not just an increase in the minimum wage, but taking it to a living wage, but understanding that that had impacts on small businesses. So we're gonna give a small business tax cut by closing corporate loopholes. I mean, every sort of progressive thing imaginable. The people weren't quite there being willing to believe that it was possible. This campaign was about breaking the illusion of impossibility.
And I'm sorry, you're just one of the smartest people I know, so I just love when you talk. And I, you know, I don't put any pressure on you, but I do want to be able to stay in the Lincoln bedroom someday. So I'm just saying, we have a whole...
What's of course funny was when I was in the General Assembly and we lived closer to D.C. in this community called Tacoma Park, before we now live on a farm on Maryland's Eastern Shore, where my wife is a clinical herbalist and we run all kinds of retreats.
That's
I'm gonna
amazing.
Get to the topic about this organization that we run now. But when we were in Tacoma Park, which is very much a lesbian community, like when I first ran for city council and I was knocking on doors, I had a woman like grill me on like, well, what, I like you and I think you're the best candidate, but I also like Juan and he is a person of color and I believe in diversity. And I was like, absolutely, totally. And I just want to make sure you understand, I would be the first out lesbian elected to the council. And she was like, honey, this is Tacoma Park. That doesn't count as diversity. So when Melissa and Linda would come and stay at our house, we literally had a room that we called the Melissa Etheridge Suite. So when we resold, you talk about the Lincoln bedroom, when we sold our house, lesbians were lined up to buy a house that had the Melissa Etheridge Suite in it.
Nice. This is, and I'm so excited that Heather's here because you're speaking today, right? What time?
Yes. Melissa and I are doing a session together at 5 o'clock in the Stardust Theater, and then I'll be back here on Saturday in this room at 1 o'clock. And what we're talking about is work that my organization, Soul Force Politics, is engaged in.
Say that again, loud.
Yes.
Soul Force Politics. Because the basis of this is pretty much radical love.
Radical love brings radical
those words.
Radical love, okay? And part of what Melissa and I will be talking about and the work of this organization is helping all of us to go in and see the divinity that is inside of us and everyone around us so that we can bring that light out into the world. And that's what we need right now is our light. And too often in this chaotic political time, Donald Trump and the darkness that surrounds him. Hold on. Yes.
I just want you to help me with that.
Here's, yeah.
Because we'll get sick otherwise, you guys.
Exactly. Yeah. We're internalizing that too much. Mm-hmm. And it's making us sick. And it's because what we're allowing to have happen is we're meeting his darkness with our own darkness.
Oh, God.
And we're going to walk through and help you find ways to meet that darkness with your own light. Okay? If you come to our workshops and listen to our podcast and engage with the work of Soul Force Politics, I know this is going to create a gasp in the room, but I will help you see Donald Trump as a gift.
He is. Seriously, it's a contrast. It's a springboard, you guys. And we are so grateful to Deb and Heather that we have been having this 8-year conversation about the world and politics and our energy. And we believe me, Melissa and I mean, our daughter worked for Hillary, okay? And that night when she called and said, Mama, I'm scared, because she was in Brooklyn for what they thought was going to be the victory, I just went to bed, and I've never felt that bad. And from that moment on, we have promised each other we're going to help others feel better. I love that you brought up depression too, Serena, because this is all, especially as women, this is all connected. You could get within 30 minutes of on your cell phone or looking at the news, get so sick and frustrated, and it gives you no benefit.
Right.
None. Now, we can't shame people. We can't shame people into doing better. You guys, there's a division that's happened. So now let's give people grace who don't have it, right? And the love that we all have in this boat, I know it sounds corny, but this feeling, I don't want you to feel like it's gonna be over. I'll get sad if I think, oh, it's over when this cruise is over. No, you gotta take this with you, okay? And it's radical love. My sweet wife, I'll say, oh my God, I can't believe that person said that to you. She'll go, I swear, I've seen energy come at her, and she is like, love, I send love. I'm like,
why, you are better person?
But it's a practice, and we're going to keep talking about it, but I want you guys to make sure you see Heather. Again, tell us when you are.
We are, Melissa and I will be on stage together in the Stardust Theater tonight at 5 o'clock. I also have handouts, flyers that give you information about our organization and these specific sessions. 5 o'clock tonight with Melissa, and then on Saturday at 1 o'clock, we're going to carry it on in a second round that's going to include more Q&A, audience participation, talking about issues that you want to bring into the Soul Force Politics dialogue.
And I wish we had I could talk to you forever, but this is the beginning of a very long conversation that we're all going to have. Heather is around to answer any questions. Deb, her amazing wife, you will fall in love with her. She's an herbalist. I mean, come on. She is an apothecary. You go to their house and go, I don't feel well. Come with me. And you go into her apothecary. It's like freaking Harry Potter. It's amazing. So please, go see Heather. We love you. Thank you, honey.
Thank you so much.
Mic drop.
Okay, Priscilla, you are here, right, honey? There you are. Okay, I'm so excited, and I'm wearing your T-shirt. This is her brand new album, ladies and gentlemen. Priscilla Renea. So much for getting up so early.
Thank you. I definitely was just sleeping.
I love you so much. I didn't get to see your show, but I was upstairs and had the door open, listened to the whole show. You are freaking amazing. And who was it, Priscilla, show last night? And we're done. I love you, Cricket. I love how, we start with the drums, like, oh my God, they're there all the time. Because it makes me laugh, you know why? He taught me how to drum, and my favorite thing he does are elves running. Do it. That makes me laugh so hard. So every time you do it, I think there's elves running.
You were wild, weren't you?
Who not me? Okay. Josie, sit on his hands. Hi.
Hello.
And these two. Come on.
Yeah.
Now, had you guys known each other before? No.
No.
Okay, that's half of my.
I accosted her at the buffet yesterday.
Oh, nice.
Okay, and did you?
Because I love her.
And
she's so busy.
The feeling is mutual.
Well, it just blows me away that that's what's the most fun is when people that we love all fall in love with each other. And people start working together. I mean, you and Sonia met on this cruise. Was it the last year?
Yeah. Well, we met right before the cruise, but we bonded when we were on board. And she's not the only one. I mean, a couple of Melissa's fans were cool. We, keep in touch, and yeah,
you guys are so great at that. Seriously, that's they do. They will stalk
you.
Yeah,
no, you guys are really good. I have to say, Melissa's fans are the most loyal.
Right?
I mean, she's so blessed to have you guys.
Now, what's fun is your parents are here.
My parents are here, and my little brother.
Are they here right now, or are they sleeping?
No, I think. My mom's definitely not sleeping. She gets up at the butt crack of dawn.
I was kind of hoping she would come down here. We would chat with her too.
I don't know what she's. I think she might be going to get acupuncture this
morning. Nice.
I talked her into it.
That's so good.
Yeah.
Does she do that?
No.
Acupuncture is the greatest.
Yeah. It is pretty awesome.
Oh my. Do you do it all the time?
Yeah, I got an appointment today.
Do you do acupuncture?
I do it all the time.
Isn't it the greatest?
Yeah. It's amazing.
Don't be scared of it. It's life-changing.
Yeah. Well, I didn't start, I used to think all that stuff was like hippie stuff. And I did. I mean, Heather kind of touched on it. Like, when you grow up a certain way, you have like a very closed-minded point of view. And it wasn't until I started getting into like higher thinking and consciousness and like chi and chakra, and I started learning about all this stuff, like meridian points, and I would bring it up to my primary physician, and he'd be like, oh yeah, like it's normal. And I'm like, so you knew about this? And you didn't tell me? Okay.
Because most doctors, they even in medical school, you don't even get a chapter on alcoholism, right? That most doctors are like, oh yeah, alternative. Oh, great,
right.
And it's really up to us to find that.
Yeah,
it's crazy.
It's like, okay, so you don't want me to actually be better. Okay, I get it.
So you said something so interesting to me at that party recently about the sound. You came up to me, I hadn't seen you when I said, I just had a sound massage.
Oh, a sound bath.
A sound bath.
Has anybody ever heard of that? A sound bath?
What? Yeah. Tell us about a sound bath.
Sound baths are so amazing. So, okay, so I'm such a nerd, this can get really deep.
Great, I love deep.
So there's frequencies going on all the time. Your cell phone, I mean, like the fridge, if you've ever been in your house and you hear like a little buzzing in your ear, all those frequencies are sort of depositing in your self, like your being, your spirit, your actual physical self, it's depositing. And what a sound bath does is there's like the frequency of the earth, there's 9 different frequencies from really deep to really high. And the sound bath does its best to hit every frequency on that spectrum for like an hour and a half maybe, and it just cleans, like shakes all the nasty frequencies out. And
you get up. So much sense, right?
You get up and you feel like,
ah. It's super cool. I love that. I've done that before too. It's
and you
amazing.
Feel completely different, right?
You do. There's like, well, with sound baths is like sound toning, right?
Yep.
So toning the energies. And there's like, I'm obsessed, I've always thought of this idea of like maybe, because you know, everything has a vibration, so you think of like, you talk about like plants coming back to life by playing classical music, right? That's kind of an idea that's been proven, right? You can hear the energy of the wave, but like, there's certain sound waves that also match up with certain colors. So
yeah.
There's a frequency that orange vibrates at. Scientifically, everything has a vibration, that's why we can see it, right? So the color orange vibrates at a certain speed. Sounds have certain speeds as well. So the note C, when you play C chord on your guitar, it's the same speed as the vibration as the color orange.
What?
So you can play sound, you can align yourself, and then you think of your chakra, the orange chakra, which is right here, it's your second chakra up. If you align and you play C and you're wearing orange, you're fucking golden.
No, it will be
your
really
second chakra
cool. It'd be really cool for you all to find out what your favorite Melissa song,
yeah,
what
colors it, playing.
It is and what color it is, and if you wear that color or eat food that's that color,
yeah.
Whoa. While you are listening to the song,
I want to
apparently
do
your head explodes.
Let's do it.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
And this is Come to My Window painted.
Oh,
yeah.
Yeah.
Right? Why not?
See, I don't think we've even touched on how this stuff can heal us, because the old paradigm is saying, nope, you're broke and I'm going to fix you, and here's a moment of 20 you're going to spend on me for me to fix you, and stuff like this. This is, why would we be on this cruise? We love this music. It makes us feel better. It makes sense that mm-hmm. sound and color, all of this is connected.
Well, that's part of the reason why my album is named Color.
What?
You know, you had... Yeah. Not a shameless plug at all, seriously. It is really because, so obviously the first like reason that you can see with your eyes is I'm brown. And a lot of people think that that's what it is, but that's like the cheapest version of the name Colored. There's so many different things that I've gone through in my, you can call it a career. I mean, when you talk about people like
it's
Melissa,
a career.
Well, I mean, she's been doing this for like so long and I'm just starting, so but I've, you know, 10 years of just being used, and you know, you should be happy to be here, just the way that women get treated in the industry,
And especially, you should be grateful for the crumbs we've given
exactly,
you.
Exactly. Especially in the pop world. I mean, I write songs for other artists, and you know, you're just
Rihanna, have you heard of her?
Mm.
Yeah.
I've had the privilege of writing for some really, really amazing women, a few men here and there, but just the way that there's not very many of us. We're going through this at South by Southwest. There's like a crazy number, like 2% of producers are female, you know, 40% of women feel they're underpaid, and just like all these crazy statistics that have to do with not enough women in these spaces. And all of that kind of like came to a head a couple years ago when I was like, if you were at my show, I spoke on it lightly. I don't want to continue helping other people live their dreams if they're not going to help me live mine.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. And I always feel so guilty saying no, you know, when somebody calls you and they're like, oh my God, you know, Ariana wants to write with you, or, you know, we need songs for Beyonce. And I'm just like, but is Beyonce going to write me a song?
Oh.
You know, I can so relate with this, because I mean, I love what I do. I love creating television shows, but what's funny is, I have, including my parents' friends, who go, Linda, I have an idea for a show. You know, I was county clerk, and the funniest things happened. I was county clerk. I'm like, I love you, Mr. Bing, but I can't. Because there was a point in my career I had to go, it's actually now, I had to go, wait, I love doing this, and it's usually talent comes to me, and I'm like, okay, I'm going to, you know, I'm going to tailor a show for you and give you the next 4 years of my life. I'm at a point now, which is still great to have this conversation. Wait, I want to do it because I don't want to spend time away from my amazing family, you know? So I am taking my TV now and turning it towards them, because if I'm going to do this, I want it to really benefit me emotionally, spiritually. So I love that you're doing that. And as women, we shouldn't ever feel guilty about that.
Oh, but they make you feel so guilty. Like, well, you don't want it. There's
Here's
a
what else. Well, who's saying, and this is what I say to a lot of young women, is it, are they, there's a lot of, people around talent, and all of this, I'm famous for barely, I'm still on AOL, I have no social media, I don't barely email, because in television, all of a sudden, people started emailing all these thoughts, and I said, anyone has a thought, you have to call me, I need to hear your voice, because there's so many people in the business of what you guys do. I watch my wife go through it, and I can tell instantly, because I'm a fly on the wall, and if I see somebody not giving her the respect, or doing that thing, like, no, this is how we're going to do it, you're going to do this, you'd be lucky to be doing this, like, I'll stop, what are you doing? This doesn't work for us, let's start over. Yeah. I'm sure you're a very nice guy, stop. This isn't going to work, and we don't have to be bulldozed into feeling guilty. I don't care what it is, if it's writing a song with somebody about babysitting for some kid or helping your friend, there's a point, and my wife has taught me this, you've got to go, wait, I got to really start self-caring, because that'll only benefit everybody. So I'm thrilled for this chapter for you.
Yeah. It's important for everyone to have a boundary, a healthy boundary that says whatever your goal is, and this is something that I just figured out maybe like a month ago, whatever your goal is, if somebody is introducing something new into your aura space, you have to ask yourself, okay, does this elevate what I want to be and who I want to be, what I want to do, or does this take away from who I want to be? And if the answer is it takes away, it doesn't matter what it is, you have to be willing to say no, thank you, next time, thank you so much. And since I've been doing that, I mean, you know, people will kind of leave you on an island, be like, I'll show you, you know, you need me. You'll be back.
That's so healthy.
Yeah.
But what I learned is that, like, this is what I do, is when I see that, I say, thank you so much for showing me who you really
Everybody's
are.
Ooh, nice.
Yeah. Woo! And thank you for being the contrast for my lesson. That's
exactly.
Great. I wouldn't have had that springboard if you hadn't.
Yeah, because if everything was so hunky-dory and like, oh, great, I get everything I want, you're not going to appreciate it.
Right.
I mean, you know, I know a lot of pop stars that are millionaires and super successful, and they are so sad and, like, not nice people.
Yeah.
And you can just see, like, the glaze over their eyes, you know? Yeah. So just
I think that's what's fun when we're all sitting with Melissa too. Again, I don't know if you're familiar with Melissa Etheridge. No, but she's been doing this now for 30 years, and part of what's amazing is she really purely loves it, and she does not do things that she doesn't want to do. That made her sick. Last night during the show, she talked, well, I don't know if you guys know, the one, only song of her entire library that she never wrote is called Breathe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that and she doesn't sing that song a lot. Maybe she will down the road, but it literally, that is the song she says gave her cancer. Huh. Because she went, no, okay, I'll do it. Oh, she didn't trust her gut. You know, and that breaks my heart every time. And I know people don't know that story, so when they say, hey, sing Breathe, and I go, oh, no, I love that one. But it's a beautiful...
So there's a song she hates singing more than...
Yes, Anita, sing it! But that really, and she's so grateful for cancer. She is so grateful for these lessons because that's when life gets interesting. You guys are young. I can say this because I wish I had gotten what you have earlier, you know, because now I'm like, so selfish, do I want this? Yes, because then when we're all together, it's like, you really want to be here. You really want to be here. You're not like, all right, I have to be here. Because people, you know, the older I get, the more you can feel it off of people too, if they want to be here or not. And it's like unhealthy food, right?
That's such a great tool to have in the industry too, whether it's film and TV or music, or even in, like, if you're in a powerful position, like, you know, Heather. I'm sure it's really great to have that radar that says, nope, this isn't genuine, you know, or all right, danger, let me exit. And we talked about this a little bit a couple nights ago. I was saying, like, when I first started in the music business, I was 18. I got discovered off the internet. I was one of the first people to get discovered off YouTube. So it wasn't cool back then. You know, my dad used to walk in the house and slap the camera off.
He hated it.
He was like, get me off the internet, you know? And everybody used to make fun of me. Like, who are you talking to? I'm talking to my fans on the computer. And now, I used to get picked on in high school about it.
All she does is sit on the computer all day.
And now, people are literally becoming millionaires off Instagram. And like,
my kids want to be YouTube stars. I said, stop.
Yeah.
No. We're going to think of better goals.
It only takes about 2 years, though.
No, because they want to play video games and have people watch them play video games.
There's people who make a lot of money doing it.
I know, but it's like, oh, God.
It's crazy. It's really weird because, you know, I got discovered off the internet and then I got signed to a major label and I did all these things. And everybody was like talking down about YouTube, like, oh, you don't need that. And now
it's the biggest.
I go into do a label meeting, you know, to try to find a home for my next record, and they're all like, well, what are your YouTube stats? What is your socials like? I'm like,
wow.
This is crazy. You guys are the same people who told me that didn't matter.
Get off the computer.
Right. Now you're telling me that I need to have that. But if I have that, then I don't need you. So it's like, it's this weird.
It's a weird thing.
It's
right?
So
and
weird.
I'm sure you go through this too, right? I mean, from the dip, you started about 10, no, 12? Well, your first album was 12.
17 years ago.
Oh, wow.
So YouTube wasn't even part of that.
No. I don't know.
But are you getting things like, what are your YouTube numbers when you walk into meetings now, or is that...
I'm sure my manager does. I kind of like unplugged myself from a lot of that recently, actually, because I was just finding it was so difficult constantly, like, I guess more like Instagram and that kind of thing, like Facebook and stuff, because I was just really was like in a K-hole. go on there and you just be like, no matter what, if you're watching something that's inspiring or whatever, you're constantly comparing yourself to everybody else's snippet of their life that's this big.
I can't imagine if we had that back in the 70s. Oh my God.
Yeah.
That's a lot of pressure.
There'd be a lot of people in jail.
There would be. Oh my God, this is so much fun. I have a question. Is it too early to sing us a little something?
Can I borrow a guitar?
Yeah,
because I didn't.
Yeah. Or I was going to say, let's just sing something, then I want to play with it a little song, because you'll have this is going to be
mine's
fun.
Mine's like a little guitar.
All right, like this one. Okay.
He's going to bring it to you.
Cricket. Let's fill in. So as we set up, I'm going to ask a question. Okay, tell me your first time you heard Melissa sing.
Okay, Sarah.
Okay. Holly and Kay Cerraz are here.
Oh, you guys, we have to get a picture.
Maybe take.
Oh, good, that was quick. Thank you for helping fill time.
So we wrote this song together. Actually, that's what I was doing. I was in his arms like him when he called. Yes, I love him so much.
Oh, we love Ray. You know, we just say hi, Ray, when you see them walking around the boat.
You know, I have to give him credit because you and Melissa, Alex, and there's a couple more people who, if it wasn't for him, we probably wouldn't have as deep of a relationship as we do, because he's such a great people person. Like, he just, he makes sure that the people that I tell him, like, you know, I really like them, they're so cool, he always makes sure that
Ray and I are like wranglers. We're like, hi, walk this way.
I think, you know what, he probably is for me what you are to Melissa, like, aww, just making sure we don't float off into space. So this song we wrote together is called Denim, and it's my favorite on the album. Like dinner.
perform at 9 p.m. on Friday in the atrium.
Yeah. So check it out.
I love Delta Rae so much that we're gonna split them up first. We're gonna bring up the girls first, and then sorry fellas, but it's the Melissa Etheridge Cruise.
Should we get
I'll pop you out and bring them in. Sorry, I'm not so sweet.
It's alright.
You're staying.
Hello.
Can we hear a little more, Melissa?
Yeah, maybe. No, we're just gonna talk like this.
So here we go. Come on up. We have say hello to Liz and Brittany, you guys from Delta Rae. Hi, you guys.
Hello.
Oh my God.
Hi, everybody.
Now, who has everyone seen Delta Rae yet?
Yeah.
If you haven't, you must. Oh my God, you guys, every time I think of you, I think I get all choked up. Just like with Serena, we first heard you, and it was, we literally, Melissa and I looked at each other and went, oh, badass angels! I mean, really, how long has it been now since we first met?
So, the story about how we first met is actually one of my favorites, and it's all thanks to Paul. Are you still here?
Paul Castro?
No, his mother is here, and yeah. She's wonderful.
She's
right there.
Thank you, Paul. Hi, Sylvia. She is the genius behind Paul. You know, Paul does all of Melissa's hair, makeup, style, and he's our eldest son. Go on.
Yes, so he did our hair and makeup for something. We were trying to remember what it was, but like
for some photo shoot in LA years ago.
Yeah, we've decided not to remember. But Paul was amazing, and we made good friends. And when he told us that he works with Melissa, we were like, what? we freaked out, and so, but that happened, and then it was like, you know, bye, and we'll see you down the line someday. And the someday was in Durham, North Carolina, which
we went to her show in Durham, North Carolina, which is where the band is from.
Yes, and when we first started this band, we were fun employed for a while until we all got, you know, jobs. I worked on a farm, Liz worked at a preschool, and then Liz started another job at our local
Performing Arts Center.
Yeah, Durham Performing Arts Center, which is where Melissa ended up playing.
Right.
So we went there on a girl date to see the show.
Lady date, and we went to see the show.
We were sitting there in the seats, we had our overpriced drink, we're like,
oh, Melissa, this is gonna be so awesome. We looked on point, and then
we didn't technical director, who I was friends with, he came out into the house. He had like his walkie-talkie. He was like, Liz, you gotta come with us. Melissa wants to meet you and Brittany right now.
We were like, and I think like, we had tweeted a video.
Brittany wasn't even still on her way to the show. I was like, oh my God, okay.
We had tweeted a video of us doing like, we did it harmony. Sounded better than that. But then I feel like Paul showed that to me. So it was like, get him back here. Do they want to sing something? And we were like, wait, can you?
Oh, so you have no idea.
You say, get him back here. Do they want to sing something?
Get him back here. Do they want to sing something?
I can only imagine that's what happened. But it seems accurate. Liz and I lost our minds.
No, I was
went
backstage.
I
made you about me.
We tried to keep her cool.
I was back with the kids.
We told her how much we loved her songs. We told her we love I'm the Only One.
And we got up there and we sang.
And she's like,
song.
You want to sing it with us? And that we were like, sure.
And you guys, I'm the Only One. You sang with her. And
we stood next to her, two really wonderful background vocalists as well.
Who were like very professional and like, hi, welcome. And we were like, hi.
In the middle of I'm the Only One, Melissa looks back at us and she goes, can you go, all right, girls, we're going to do a sing-off.
All right, girls, we're going to do a sing-off.
I mean, you kind of held it down there with that.
She looks back and she comes over to us. She's like, I'm the only one. And then I was like, I'm the only one.
Wait a minute. You did the back and forth.
So we did the back and forth.
Okay, wait. And then I'll finish the story because we're talking so long.
No, but this is a talk show. And I'm drunk with power, so we're gonna be here.
So we did that one-off, which was just on a whim in Durham, and then she got in touch with us and was like, I'm gonna fly you guys out to sing on my DVD in LA. So she flew me and my brothers out, and Liz, sorry, me. I went like this. Me drove my better half, Liz, and our brothers out to sing on this DVD, and so that was a dream come true. We got to spend more time together, and I mean, it's been an incredible
Well, you know, you changed your life with you guys singing I'm the Only One with Her, because she looked at me afterwards and went, I've been singing that by myself all these years. Them singing with me, it's like, wow. And I don't think she can live without it true now.
Well, hey.
We were terrified the first time.
Good morning, Cruise. Six Man Jenna here, and I have a special guest with me who would like to say a few words to y'all.
Good morning, Cruisers. For jam-packed day. We've got my first photo session happening in just a few minutes. You can check your key card to see which session you are a part of. Later, we have a cooking demo with my good friends Kathy and Jerome Jenkins. You don't want to miss that. There's incredible music throughout the whole day, and I'll be participating in a discussion with Heather Mizeur regarding soul force politics. It's going to be a great day. Have fun out there, and I will see you soon.
But she does this up in our room, and she's literally got a robe on and hair and makeup, and she's got her glasses, and she's standing there in the bar. So anyway, okay, so back to us.
She's been an amazing advocate. She's been so encouraging of us. We were lucky enough to open up for her at the Ryman.
That was crazy.
A little while after that, and we sang with her on Pulse, which is an amazing, amazing song that she put out.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
We're just best friends since I was 7 years old.
We are work-wise.
And we are, yes, we have gone to counseling together. So, you know, we really got it all.
And then maybe you can explain how the band works, because your brothers are over there. There's Ian and Eric, right?
Yes, my two older brothers are there. My parents are here also.
Wait, straight white male feminists back there.
Yay! Yes.
Wait, where's your mom and dad?
My dad is the tall individual sitting. And my mom is sitting with my brothers.
Hi.
She's
very
small.
My mom is here too. She's also named Priscilla. She's back there. Wave, mommy.
Hi.
She's amazing.
She's representing in her Delta Rae t-shirt.
That's wonderful.
Yep.
Yeah. Persistent resistor. She's got her persistent resistor shirt on.
Yeah.
I'm so in love with you guys. And so, had you met Serena before?
We've not met. Just met. But you've been a big fan since her first single that we heard was Stomp Your Feet. Is that?
Yeah.
I mean, when that came out on the scene, we were like, oh shit. Okay, so we are up our game. We're gonna stomp it out. We've got a few stops, we need a few more. That was a road song for us, for sure.
That's so cool. That way you took your shoes off.
Yeah, the other night I actually had regrets.
That's amazing.
Did you? Okay.
Oh,
thank you so much.
Heard that song.
Well, they're going to
hear this song. Yeah, so you guys will be singing tonight?
We're singing it, we're in the 80s, the 80s
song. Oh, yeah.
I love how Liz says that we're in the 80s.
We've got hair streaks that I'm going to put in.
Yeah.
And then we're also, Delta Rae's playing a set at the atrium on Friday at 6:45. Come check it out. It's going to be great. We're going to have some special guests as well.
We are going to have some special guests.
Now, you guys are going to sing a song. You want to tell us about what, this is something new, right?
Yeah, we will sing you guys our latest single, and actually it really relates back to the whole beginning of this amazing talk show. And it's our song for the Me Too movement, and we released it last year during the Brett Kavanaugh hearings.
I'm sorry, not familiar with that. It's okay, with love, we send love. Remember, we send love. Okay,
do it!
We're trying.
We kind of reached a boiling point with this song. We've been performing it for the full year, and we, you know, it was inspired by the Me Too movement, which has been so powerful in initiating a change that is so profoundly long overdue. But that felt like a fever pitch moment with Brett Kavanaugh, and we sent a message to our label that was like, we absolutely cannot wait to release the song. We are releasing it this month. Let's go. We made a video for it. We had no plan or budget. We made it in my house by ourselves and incorporated incredibly diverse and beautiful women and non-binary folks in our community in Nashville. And if you haven't seen the video, I hope you'll check it out. But it's it was our statement to get people to go out and vote in the midterm elections and try and, you know, if we couldn't stop what was happening with the Supreme Court, at least make the sort of long-term changes, it, you know, little by little. And I firmly believe that those kind of the big revolution will happen with small evolutionary changes in our local government. So, you know, making sure that we all get out and vote instead of just in the big, you know, presidential one. But all
and this is such a hot, and I'm glad because someone brought it up earlier. It's such a big topic. That the fact that you guys are, as artists, taking this, because sometimes the best thing we can do is make art, give it to the world, and hopefully people now can share the song, because you have, the family members are fighting over each other about political beliefs, and it's like sometimes now you can send a song like that to somebody, or somebody, Melissa even has a new song on her new album from the same issue, and she said, gosh, I want to write a song that will give people hope. Not and find a way. So there, that's the power of the art that you're doing, and I'm so glad you're gonna do it for us. So now we can bring up those fellas, right?
Yeah.
Are they gonna
see
this?
The drumming is so wonderful. Thank you so much.
Cricket, let's hear it for Cricket.
Yeah. So, to your point, I think that this song, my brother Ian and I wrote it. He actually wrote the majority of it. I just came in and was like, let me offer a female perspective on this feminist empowerment anthem. And, but talk about my mom, who's here, was a gay rights activist in the 90s in Cobb County, Georgia. So yeah. She debated Sean Hannity on the radio, and he kept muting her mic so she couldn't make her fantastic points. My dad called the radio station, was like, I'm gonna kill you. And we were like, let's put you on the air, sir.
You know what's weird, Brittany? We asked Sean Hannity on this cruise, and he said no.
I know. Just mute his mic. But our parents, you know, did raise Liz's mom is a single mom and one of the fiercest women I know. And
tough as nails.
Yeah, that is teacher and principal. Anyway, we're all so grateful that we get to deliver this message of empowerment, and it does take the Me Too phrase, and I hope turn it on its head and make it a hopeful one. But I hope you all enjoy this. This is called Hands Dirty.
One, two,
three, four. I could raise the crops from the earth. I could raise my children from birth. But when I'm looking for work, they say that job ain't for her. I could be a good man's wife. I could give a new child life. But when I fight for my rights, they say no woman, no pride. But I ain't giving up. I can't count on love. I get my hands dirty. I show up so early. They show me no mercy. So I just keep working. Maybe God could save me. Or my
I do what I always do. I can't.
Just one, I'm so embarrassed. Keep going, but we'll laugh about this.
Don't apologize. Let's sing it with us.